Okay, so she's not the perfect mom. She's not the perfect size. And she doesn't have the perfect look. Reality star and author Jen Hatmaker says that's okay. There's something called grace. On today's 700 Club Interactive. Hi, and welcome to the show. Are you struggling to live the unattainable Pinterest life? The life where all your pictures on Facebook show a happy family wearing the latest fashions and going to the coolest places?
Well, if you need to be liberated from society's impossible standards, you are not alone. In today's show, you'll meet several women who need an extra dose of grace too, starting with these lovely ladies. Take a look.
Mom, what's for dinner?
If you have a hidden addiction.
What? No season two? I'm not gonna know if he lives.
If you need a bit more support than you used to.
Ah, yes. I thought I lost you.
If you're thankful for car mirrors on your way to work.
Dinner served?
If you're a creative cook.
What is this?
Fish tacos.
Okay.
Bad tummy.
If your child likes to point out the obvious. If coffee has this effect on you.
Hey, hi guys. I'm so glad you could come to Bible study.
Then know this. You're off the hook. So you have flaws. Okay, you're not the Pinterest perfect woman. And maybe you don't look like the magazine models. But in a world of impossible standards, there's good news. It's called grace.
And we welcome back to the show author, blogger, mother of five, pastor's wife, and reality TV personality, Jen Hatmaker, as if all of the above wasn't enough, right?
Oh, my goodness. Thank you for having me.
Oh, it's great to have you back.
Thank you.
I want to talk a little bit about the big issue that so many women face. You see it there. We're surrounded by invitations to perfection. Mm. And how does one find balance?
Isn't that a great question? And I just don't have time for any of that nonsense, that perfect ideal anymore. People ask me all the time, Jen, you just do this and this and this, and how do you balance it all? And I'm here to tell you, I don't even think that's real. I think balance is not even achievable. I think we've invented this idea that some of us are nailing it and some of us are not. I think it's seasonal, because balance implies it's all the same. Mm-hmm. Everything's weighted equally, and that's never true.
Yeah,
and so I am getting very comfortable with the word no. Yeah. I am getting very comfortable with the phrase, I cannot do that right now. Mm-hmm. And I'm also learning how to set aside all the guilt that used to come with that.
And that's what you do in your book. You give permission to the rest of us to join you on that journey of freedom.
I really do. In For the Love, I have an essay called On the Beam, and I use this metaphor. Some things just do not belong on the beam. Some things go off the beam, and women particular. I think we struggle with this more than men. I'm not sure, but I think we have this mechanism that says, I should always say yes, I should always be agreeable, and I should always be amazing all the time. And I think it's really ruining us on the inside. And so I am here to tell you, no, ma'am. Yeah. Off the beam it goes, and we're going to live in freedom.
And you're very candid about the fact that you've done that in your own life. I mean, I kind of chuckled when you, as a pastor's wife, freely, because of the other things that God has in your life right now, say, I can't do that study right now. I can't belong to that group right now. I mean, we need to know when enough is enough and when good enough is enough.
That's right. I hope that sets a lot of people free. My husband is the lead pastor of our church, and there are so many really beautiful and wonderful and good church things that I say no to, that I cannot participate in, because we cannot do it all. That's the message. I mean, this is not a book to tell women how to do it all. It's a book to say, you can't do it all, and that's okay, and you are already doing amazing in the spaces that you're in. So I hope it's liberating.
And you talk about giving ourselves some grace. You know, I think we all try to do that anyway with our spouses, with our children, with friends. But you say sometimes we need to give grace to ourselves, and you can't earn that. It's unmerited, isn't it?
I think that's where it begins. And I think when it comes, you know, we're sort of a grace-starved culture right now. All you have to do is look around and see how people are just lonely and they are hurting and we're isolating one another. Mm-hmm. And I think this is an inside job. When we are able to receive grace for ourselves, I find that we are so much better able to give it away. And so I always tell women, let's start with you. You have grace. You don't have to earn it. You don't have to be good enough for it. It's a free gift. Mm-hmm. And so our biggest job is to learn how to receive it.
Yeah. You have a chapter in the book called Dear Church. You know, church is probably one of the places where we most want to contribute something and sometimes can feel the most pressure to measure up to something. So talk a little bit about how we as church people can have grace and extend grace, because that's where it should begin, isn't it?
I'm a lifer in church, pastor's daughter, pastor's wife. I love the local church and believe in her. Mm-hmm. And so one thing that I know experientially is that there's no better place to hide than the church. I mean, you can get in there. I know all the language. I know all the rules.
You can know all the songs.
I know all the songs. I know the alto version of all the songs. And so I'm so hopeful for the church if we will learn as a community to be transparent and truthful. It is absolutely transformative. I have seen it, and for me, I believe it starts top down. I would love to see our pastors have the courage and the bravery to stand in front of us and say, this is what's true about me.
Yeah.
This is where I'm struggling. This is what I've struggled with in the past, and God has helped me overcome. Honesty and vulnerability is incredibly powerful. And I think once we set that loose in our churches and we stop hiding from one another, I believe we'll see God's kingdom come in our generation.
I couldn't agree with you more. I see that in my own church. I have a pastor that does that. And you know, it draws people. It draws people because we're all coming together in our brokenness to love each other, grow, and move forward. And it's a good thing.
It is a good thing. And I think that's what people misunderstand. What seems to be the very scariest thing, which is to tell the truth, is actually the thing that draws people to you. It doesn't push you away. When you say something true to me, I'm not afraid of you. I'm not going to hide from you. You'll be the first person I come to.
Exactly.
And so what a powerful message to send among believers.
Mm-hmm. You say that with the reality show that you did, I can't even imagine doing a reality show with my family. It's terrifying.
It was terrifying.
But you said that the experience caused you to set stricter boundaries for your family. What do you mean by that?
Yeah, let me explain. The show actually, in a strange paradox, ended up being so good for our family. It was so much togetherness, and it was so much time working alongside with each other. And so at the end of the show, when we had just really come together, we said, we need more of this.
Yeah.
We didn't realize how much we had let that fall until we were sort of forced into such close proximity. And so at the end of the show, we said, okay, that's it. We need to protect our family time better. And so we set tighter boundaries around our evenings. We sit around our dinner table and have dinner together almost every night of the week,
nice.
Which means we say no to a lot of other things. We tell our kids now, no phones in the morning. Morning, we're going to have conversation. We're going to look each other in the eye. We are going to speak words to each other. And so it seems that seems radical in today's phone culture.
Yeah.
I mean, I have a bunch of teenagers. They all have phones. I want to throw their phones against the wall sometimes. And so we just said, this is worth protecting.
Yeah.
And we will say no when everybody else is saying yes, if that makes it more accessible to our family.
Yeah. There's so much wise counsel in Jen's book, and I just want to highly recommend it to you, because in addition to the wise counsel is an inordinate amount of laughter. It is such a fun read, but it's also very thought-provoking. If you'd like to get a copy of her new book, it's called For the Love. It's available wherever books are sold, and I highly, highly recommend it. Great to have you back.
Thank you, Terry. Always good to see you.
Anxious to see what you do next.
Thank you.
Andrew, over to you.
Thank you so much, Terry. Well, still ahead, a woman who faced insurmountable odds from the very moment she was born.
He told his staff to give me half eatings because he believed my body would weaken and die, and I would ultimately die of a hospital infection.
Watch her become an overcomer. Her inspiring story is right after this.
Lisa Olson has a warm heart, a great smile, and a twinkle in her eye. But when she was a baby, she was nearly killed because of what she didn't have. Lisa not only survived, but thrived. And Michelle Wilson brings us her incredible story.
Lisa Olson does what most all women do before leaving the house.
I'm a typical woman. I like to apply makeup and style my hair.
But for Lisa, it's not so easy.
I was born without arms and legs.
Lisa depends on people for almost everything. Today, her caregiver Raina helped her put on her favorite dress and the pearls her mom Marie gave her. Her mom inspired her to overcome any of the challenges she would face in life. Lisa says she's her inspiration.
Mom just encouraged me to persevere and to never give up.
In spite of her disability, she didn't let anything stop her from following her dreams. She learned how to drive, competed in Special Olympics, traveled the world, and earned 2 degrees. She's come a long way considering she was almost euthanized after her birth. Lisa's story begins in Manipal, India. She was born on September 8, 1974, with no limbs. It's believed that thalidomide, a drug her mother took for morning sickness during pregnancy, was to blame. Her parents dropped her off at the Kasturba Medical College in Kasturba, India. Lisa later learned that the head of pediatrics wanted to euthanize her.
He told his staff to give me half eatings because he believed my body would weaken and die, and I would ultimately die of a hospital infection.
Dr. Corvilla George, a Christian, objected. He traveled 37 hours by 2 buses and 2 trains with baby Lisa in a basket to the Ramabai Mukti Mission. There, she was given the name Manyata, which in Marathi means acceptance. She lived there for 5 years until she was adopted by Marie Olson, the director of the Hopetown Christian School in Carmel, New York. She named her Lisa Manyata Olson.
Mom always said that what won me over to her was that she had seen a black and white picture of me winking, and that seemed to warm her heart.
Now, in a loving Christian home, Lisa accepted Jesus as Savior at 5.5 years old. Over the years, her mother taught her to take care of herself and enjoy life. Lisa still remembers their adventures.
One of my favorite memories of my mom was going sleigh riding, and I would sit on her lap, and she would be the one yelling, ah! And I would lean back into her, sit on her lap, and put my head back and close my eyes.
Marie also taught Lisa how to persevere and was there to help her when her challenges became overwhelming.
She would talk to me and just say, well, you have a lot of blessings in your life, and to think of the positive aspects in my life.
Those loving words of encouragement would enable Lisa to take on obstacles for years to come. She's completed her bachelor's from Lee College in 1993 and received a master's degree in communication at Regent University in 1999.
Hello, Robertson School of Government. This is Lisa Olson.
Now a career services manager, Lisa gives credit to her mom for her success, whom she lost in 2012 after she suffered for many years with Alzheimer's.
I saw God's hand even in her illness. The Lord just gave me the overwhelming sense of peace and that, you know, that He was always going to be there for me. She was, you know, in the presence of her Savior, whom she loved so much and whom I do as well.
Sure, yes.
When she helps her students accomplish their career goals, she thinks of her mother who inspired her to become the woman she is today.
I definitely love to fellowship with them and encourage them and to help them to see the plans and the purpose that God has for their lives.
Lisa dreams of being married one day. Until then, she keeps herself busy inspiring others through her Christian-based motivational speaking ministry she established in 2010 called Manyata Ministries. She speaks all over the world, letting others know they can overcome any setback with God's help.
There are so many hurting people out there, and they need to know the love of Christ, and they need to know that God is their source of strength. The Lord says that He has good plans and purpose for our lives and plans to prosper you and not to harm you and to give you that hope in the future.
amazing story of victory, of courage, of vision. You know, just an amazing woman who really understands her value in Christ, the deep love of Christ, and God's plan and purpose for her continues to unfold.
Yeah, she's so inspiring. I've met Lisa before on the mm-hmm. Regent University campus, and she's always been an inspiration, and her yes. courage just really captures your heart. I never knew the story before about Marie, the mm-hmm. woman who adopted her, and this doctor who saved her life. And it also speaks to us about stepping out and serving others. Look at the yeah. life change due to yes. people sacrificing maybe their own interests for someone else.
And now she's speaking around the world to people who need a ray of hope in their circumstances. And she brings not just a ray of hope, but a picture of the grace of God and the strength of God and the courage of God. And what an amazing ministry.
And speaking of pictures, I love the one that she talked about sleigh riding with her uh-huh. mom, and she would just lean back and close her eyes.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's like that on our God adventures too.
That almost always, because they can be pretty scary sometimes. Well, coming up, actress and comedian Coco Brown talks about praying through the pain.
Child, I talked to him so much, I don't think he gets out of hearing from me.
And why laughter is the best medicine. That's next.
Well, the Bible says laughter is like medicine, and we want to introduce you to a woman who has spent her life serving up a healthy dose of that. You'll recognize her from TV shows like Psych and films like Ted 2. She was born Farrah Brown, but her stage name is Coco Brown. And she's sitting down with CBN's Ephraim Graham in our Studio 5.
Coco Brown.
Tag me in, Coach. Now this chick gonna be all up in C-Sports. Mm-hmm. Part owner.
Is a familiar face on television and films. It's been said that when the actress and comedian takes the stage, the world stands still.
So you grew up in Newport News?
Uh-huh, born and raised.
How did you or when did you realize you were funny?
Honestly, it was the first time I went on TV. I mean, honestly, you know, if you let my friends tell it when I was in high school, in elementary school, middle school, whatever, they always said I was funny, I was always quick, I was always witty. But for real, I never knew I could get paid doing this.
Brown starred in the Tyler Perry film Single Moms Club, and she plays the role of Jennifer in his television show, For Better or Worse.
Ooh, she went to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 school. She's smart. It's kind of expensive in here.
Yeah.
You paying for this, right?
I'm not paying for this. Well, I better not. Never do it.
No! You ain't gonna make me pay and get my boob squeezed. No!
Did your mom, parents, did they know
no,
you?
No, they thought I was crazy.
Really?
They had just spent all that money for a degree, and I said, I'm gonna be a comic. My parents looked at me like I had two heads. And the first time I ever did comedy, my parents came to a show I did in Norfolk, Virginia, and my mom walked out the club after my show, and she said, baby, who told you was funny? No lie, no lies.
Real curious, so do you see the world, you think, differently than the average Joe who doesn't necessarily look at things and see humor in them?
I do find humor in things that aren't funny, that really shouldn't be funny. You know, I really do. I mean, you know, and I think that's the twistedness of most stand-up comics. Because most of us, you know, our comedy comes from pain, something that has hurt us, something that is traumatizing or whatever. And we've learned how to laugh at it. You know, I always say I love Kevin Hart, but he doesn't have the patent on pain. You know, mm-hmm. we've all laughed at our pain. That's how we get through being in this business. I mean, I laughed through my divorce. Most people would have probably flung themselves off of a bridge with some of the stuff I went through, but I had to laugh at it. Mm-hmm. I mean, I remember sitting in the courtroom cracking up, and the judge was like, you all right? I'm like, sir, Your Honor, I just got to laugh at this right now. Look, I'm sorry, Your Honor. Because otherwise I'm going to jump across this thing and kill the man. So, you
know, so. Whoa.
So, yeah, you got to find the humor in everything.
I read that many of your fans call you the truth. Why is that?
Because I always say, I don't tell jokes, I tell the truth. What I put out there is literally, I give you a bird's eye view into my life, into what I've been through. I don't get up there and try to tell you knock-knock jokes or very generalized, you know, when I went to the bathroom joke. No, what you're hearing is pretty much my diary, my life unfold before you. I talk about, you know, being single. I talk about finally getting married and then finding out who you married was not who you thought they were, and then becoming a single mom and raising a little boy and trying to potty train a little boy when you can't teach him how to stand up. You know, you know, I talk about about things that really relate to me.
Where for you is God in all that pain that you went through?
Child, I talk to him so much, I think he gets tired of hearing from me. You know, I always say that, I have a joke that I say in my act, you know, when I do stand up, you know, I'm not clean and I'm gonna keep it real. Mm-hmm. But I do talk about God a lot in my act. And people sometimes will give you that look. And I said, don't judge me. God knows my heart. He knows my mouth ain't caught up yet. You know, and, you know, for me, you know, with all that I've been through, I mean, I've been on my own literally since I was 17. I mean, I went to college and I did what my parents, you know, I came from a very traditional Southern household. You go to college, get a degree, you get married, you have some babies. You know, I went far left after I graduated. I became a stand-up comic and decided to say, you know, whatever with this degree, I'm going to be a stand-up. And, you know, I always say I put God first. I mean, this business is relentless. And it is mean, and it is unfair, and you constantly have to convince yourself of your worth, because if you let this business define you, God help you.
Before we end, I want to play a little bit of a game and just throw out some names of people that I believe you've worked with. If you haven't, don't worry about it, and just get your first impressions of what you recall.
Okay.
Samuel Jackson.
Cool. So cool. Real cool.
Kelsey Grammer.
Hilarious. Hilarious. Yes.
Nia Long.
Beautiful. Beautiful spirit.
Mm-hmm. Terry Crews.
A fool. A funny fool. I loved it.
Whenever I see him and think of you, it's always the funeral, the funeral reunion.
Yes. And that was his idea. Okay.
Really?
Yes. That was not in the script. I don't know where he found it, but he bought it on set and was like, we're just like, and that's what, you know, Tyler would do. He would let stuff just fly. And, you know, you look like, you know, improv. And you're like, okay, that's not in the script, but I'm going to roll with it.
Okay.
So, yeah. Okay.
Tyler Perry.
Gosh. Brilliant. Brilliant.
And last, Oprah Winfrey.
The queen. The queen. Yes, the queen. Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me. It's such a pleasure.
Thank you, Coco, for reminding us to laugh. We need to do that more, Terry.
Sure,
you know,
do.
I get a lot of that in my household with my kids. There's an awful lot of amusement going on, usually at my expense. Keeps me humble, right? Kids are
always
doing
that. That's the best kind. You can really laugh then.
Yeah. The laughter is like medicine. We need to remember that. We have a team here at 700 Club Interactive who loves to pray for you, and Jessica Chacko leads that team. We want to go over to Jessica now and see what people are asking for prayer. Jessica, good morning.
Good morning, Andrew. Well, thanks. If you need prayer for anything, please call us. The number is on your screen, 888-777-1999. Or you can leave us a prayer request on Facebook. We read your prayer requests, and we have a team of people who prays for them. Speaking of which, we have one from Georgina who wrote in on Facebook, please pray for my daughter Lucy, who has suffered severe depression for many years. She's estranged from her children and is extremely emotionally vulnerable. Please pray that the Lord will deliver her. Thank you. Nancy says, my three precious adopted teenagers, Josh, Roxy, and Caleb, need prayer for major emotional wounds. Marilyn writes, please pray for my mother, who has been addicted to gambling with cards. And finally, here's one from Joy. She says, please pray for my granddaughter, who has been diagnosed as a kleptomaniac, and the psychologists say she's beyond help. I believe God can cure her. Thank you very much. Well, if you are watching, maybe you can relate to some of these prayer needs, and maybe someone has told you that you're beyond help. But you know what? As we have learned today from Jen Hatmaker, there is grace for us, and God's grace covers all of our weaknesses, all of our shortcomings. So let's go to prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much today that we can stand before you, not condemned, but Father, as children who know, God, we are imperfect. We can't be perfect. If we were perfect in and of our own strength, we wouldn't need Jesus. And Lord, we thank you that your grace comes covers us. For those who have written in, who need prayer, who need grace in their lives, who need healing, who need deliverance, Father, we ask that you touch them now in Jesus' name. For Lucy, who is struggling with depression, Lord, we pray that she be healed emotionally from the inside out. For the three children, Roxy and Caleb, Father, we just pray that you would touch them, that you would deliver them. For Joy's granddaughter, Father, we just pray that your love would overwhelm her and deliver her from this illness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Andrew?
Amen. Thank you, Jessica. We leave you with these words from 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 14. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. For Terry and Jessica, I'm Andrew Knox. We'll see you next time on 700 Club Interactive. Bye-bye.